Motion 3748, the name of Fiona Hislop, on celebrating our past, Scotland's year of history, heritage and archaeology. I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now. And can I say before I start, there's a little time in hand, so it's 6 minute speeches on open debate, but there is time for interventions. I call on Fiona Hislop to speak to and move the motion. Cabinet Secretary, 12 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. From our historic towns to our majestic brooding castles, from the industrial wonder of the Forth Bridge to the mysteries of the standing stones of Callanish, Scotland's history, heritage and archaeology is fascinating, set in wonderful landscape, telling stories of fortitude, power and drama of people and of their places. And we inspire and captivate imagination from Scots and visitors alike throughout our history, heritage and archaeology. Scotland's landscape is incredibly rich with the evidence of its history, from surviving Neolithic tombs and homes to fascinating and enigmatic carved stones, to medieval castles, Renaissance palaces, and some of the finest surviving Georgian urban planning anywhere in the world. And there is much more. So as well as celebrating our successes in previous themed years, this debate also allows us to shine a spotlight on Scotland's wealth of fascinating and inspiring history, heritage and archaeology. Today I will highlight this year as a celebration of Scotland's rich and diverse historic environment, its vibrant heritage, world-renowned archaeology, key draws both to the people of Scotland and its visitors. And I also intend to acknowledge the social, economic and cultural benefits of heritage and of taking full advantage of the opportunities offered to raise the profile of Scotland both nationally and internationally as a world-class tourism destination. Archaeology can also act as a real catalyst for local communities and provide inspiration and activities for communities to come together and celebrate their local heritage. Scotland's Community Heritage Conference celebrates that public role of archaeology and showcases community-led projects across Scotland and supports people as they explore their connection to the past. And we already have an exciting programme of annual events in place which celebrate these themes year after year, from the Edinburgh Festivals to the Jousting Weekend held every year at Linlithgow Peel, from Doors Open Day to the Festival of Museums, to name just a few. This year's Winter Festival events, including Celtic Connections and Burns Night, provided a fantastic opportunity to celebrate our intangible heritage, made up of our language, of stories, of songs, of crafts and of traditional food and drink. These are rightly famous across the globe. And last week, I was delighted to attend three events which marked the finale of this season's Winter Festivals and also the start of the year of history, heritage and archaeology. Burns Unbound at the National Museum of Scotland and Night at the Museum at the Hunterian were both popular free events open to all, which invited local communities, families and visitors to celebrate and learn more about the life and works of the Bard in the unique setting provided by these two world-renowned sites. Bemis celebrates Burns at Celtic Connections with a spectacular musical finale of the multicultural celebration of the Year of Innovation, Architecture and Design and Winter Festivals. It was supported by £54,000 of funding from the Scottish Government. And this programme has been a great success, inspiring a wide range of minority ethnic communities to collaborate on the delivery of 63 events across the country, attended by around 15,000 people. And all of the events supported by the programme were developed and delivered at grassroots level and provided the opportunity for local people to share and celebrate their own unique cultures, history and stories, and also what Scotland means for them as a home. And the programme of themed years has been very successful in giving Scottish tourism an edge, galvanising partners and working across sectoral boundaries to create a strong collaborative platform to promote Scotland and our many assets. They will also significantly help us to grow the contribution from our tourism industry to the economy as we aim to increase that contribution to over £5.5 billion a year by 2020. Our 2012 Year of Creative Scotland reached almost 70 million people. The 2013 Year of Natural Scotland saw a 12% increase in the number of visitors to rural and coastal locations compared to the same period in 2012. And there were over 1 million attendances at 2015 Year of Food and Drink funded events. And during last year's Year of Innovation, Architecture and Design, there were 30 funded and 125 partner programme events In addition, over 1 million people have engaged in the centenary celebration of the Festival of Architecture, and it saw 460 additional events taking place all over Scotland. So looking forward to 2018, we're going to be celebrating in Scotland a global first by having a year-long celebration of the very best of Scotland and its young people, a programme of cultural and educational events and activities co-designed with children and young people to be held across Scotland, to celebrate Scotland as a great place for young people to grow up in and to mark their contribution to Scottish society. But this is 2017, and we're extremely fortunate in Scotland to have the most fascinating and inspiring history and heritage on our doorsteps, and that brings the spirit of Scotland alive. Our built heritage infrastructure is a key asset. It contributes strongly to the Scottish economy and must be maintained. And heritage-based tourism alone generated an estimated £780 million for the Scottish economy in 2015, supporting 23,100 jobs across the sector. It is not all about our iconic buildings and internationally renowned artefacts, however. Every part of Scotland has its own story to tell, and we have many hidden gems to find and explore, and I'm sure we'll hear some of them during the debate.
Alexander Stewart.
For taking an intervention, Deputy Presiding Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that slow or ill-informed decisions regarding the planning process can sometimes have a knock-on effect when it comes to the viability of conservation and Scotland's built heritage?
Cabinet Secretary.
I acknowledge there are challenges in the planning system. Obviously, there's a current review, but I would reassure the member that during actually the Heritage Environment Act that came into force in the last few years, we deliberately made a point of trying to make sure that we could do parallel processes so that we actually, I think, saved 6 weeks off some of the processes that were involved. We've already done that, and we're always looking for opportunities to do that in a way that respects the heritage, but also make sure the decision-making can be done in a very timely way. But in terms of looking globally, we've got 50 million people claiming Scottish ancestry. Genealogical research is growing. It's an important niche market in Scotland. And we know people want to visit where their ancestors came from. That really keeps their history alive. And members will be aware of the most recent successes of television programmes which use Scotland as a backdrop, notably and famously in Outlander, which has also helped increase interest in people's past. And the numbers make it clear. Research by Visit Scotland shows that 68% of North Americans cite ancestry as a reason to travel to Scotland, and that ancestral tourists in general stay longer and spend significantly more than the average visitor. So we take genealogical interest very seriously. We have supported the establishment of the Scottish Ancestral Tourism Group, and that's to helping develop within the sector. And we also recognise the benefits that the clans bring to our tourism industry, especially through the strong overseas membership that the clan associations have. And that's why we continue to fund the Clan Event Fund. It has supported 22 events to date among 17 clans, and nine further events are planned for 2017, encouraging more people to embrace their ancestry. And this year's Splash of Tartan programme at the 2017 Royal Edinburgh Military Tattoo has taken on board our clan traditions. The Standing Council has already helped encourage over 50 clans to participate in each night of the tattoo. Recognising the value of the spectacle, I agree that the existing available resources within the Clan Event Fund could be utilised to support clans organising events across Scotland to enhance engagement. And I'll be in a position to announce successful applicants shortly. So we have much to celebrate, and rightly so, but we're also stewards of our heritage and must rise to the challenge of its care. And that is why I commissioned Historic Environment Scotland to undertake an unprecedented survey of the properties in care of Scottish ministers. This report highlighted the need for a new focus on their care and maintenance, alongside action to address the impacts of climate change. And despite the very challenging financial position, I was pleased to be able to announce an additional £6.6 million for the properties when I visited Doune Castle earlier this month. And I was also able to maintain their overall budget, as in previous years, I have protected their important, often game-changing support to other organisations through their external grants programme. And those grants will also help to lever in significant additional funds to the benefit of our historic environment and indeed the wider economy with local businesses and skills. So we know through evidence from Visit Scotland and other research that many more visitors come from all over the world to view and experience Scotland's history, heritage and archaeology. The major driver for the industry, and this year presents an exciting opportunity to build on that performance. Visitor research findings show that 32% of visitors to Scotland came in 2015 for the history and culture. More than half of visitors said they visited a stately home or castle. Many others visit museums and galleries or cathedrals or churches. And the evidence is clear that at every level of the tourism industry, there are major assets for us. And our top two visitor attractions in terms of numbers are consistently the National Museum of Scotland and Edinburgh Castle. So this year will, as usual, include a busy and exciting events programme. I can highlight some of the events for 2017 that are being supported through the £300,000 year of History, Heritage and Archaeology Signature Events Fund. The events will form a key element of the programme for the year, and the fund is administered by Visit Scotland. The events will be held across the nation from Unst to Paisley and all Scotland's six World Heritage Sites and virtually for St Kilda. I encourage members to explore what events are happening in their area, but also to take an opportunity to go further afield. And the Heritage Lottery Fund have also created a £500,000 dedicated grant fund, Stories, Stones and Bones, to encourage people in communities across Scotland to explore their past and find out more about their local history, customs and traditions. And they announced the first set of successful applicants earlier in the month, and a further round of applications closed today. So I know the fund has received a tremendous response, including young people in inner city schools wanting to learn to build buildings with turf, to the deaf community wanting to help make heritage sites more accessible. And this further demonstrates that there is an exceptional interest in celebrating Scotland's rich heritage from across the country. And there are also some significant anniversaries and events taking place, which will also form part of the year. Edinburgh will celebrate its 70th anniversary as the world's leading international festival city in 2017. First held in 1947, the festival has provided a strong and lasting platform for reconciliation in the aftermath of the Second World War. And today, all of the festivals and their strong value of internationalism continue to reinforce the richness of migration and our shared histories, formulating and shaping our future aspirations. So I am, President Officer, excited by the prospect of the Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology. I hope that members in this chamber are as inspired as I am, both by how it will increase our already extremely strong heritage offer in history and archaeology. I'm closing, but yes, indeed, yep.
Mr. MacArthur.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for taking an intervention in our final minute. I think it's impossible in this area to touch on absolutely everything, but I'm slightly surprised that there wasn't a reference to the World Heritage Sites that do so much to attract people to Scotland, particularly the World Heritage Site in Orkney, Neolithic Orkney. Would you agree that our world-class sites require world-class infrastructure and visiting facilities, and will she commit to that in this year?
Good for you to get Orkney in there, Mr. MacArthur.
Well, I think I've already mentioned Orkney. I've mentioned the Forth Bridge, and indeed, if the member had been listening, he would have acknowledged that they're actually, as part of the major signature events, they are taking place in six of the World Heritage Sites. I did point out that the one to do with St Kilda would be virtual, but I, as he knows, I'm always willing and able to promote World Heritage Sites. But I'd also acknowledge that part of the issue, and that's why, as part of the investment that I announced for properties in care, some of that investment clearly will be for the physical infrastructure in terms of the existing traditional structures themselves. But some of it, as in Doon Castle, will also be about how do you help enhance the visitor experience, because managing increasing numbers of people, and I know that's an experience in Orkney, can be a real challenge. So I appreciate that point. So in terms of what we can do to continue to show Scotland as a modern, dynamic country, we also need to make sure that we also connect to our past and understand the value that history and heritage can bring. So I welcome the opportunity that today's debate provides to recognise the contribution of the themed years and to celebrate and promote some of our greatest assets. I think there's a responsibility for all members to champion our heritage, whether it is locally in their own communities, and I hope to hear more of that in the debate as we go forward, but also nationally across Scotland. So, Presiding Officer, I move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much. I call Alexander Stewart to speak to and move Amendment 3748.2, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. On behalf of the Scottish Conservatives, I am very pleased to take part in today's debate on Scotland's Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology. These themed years, as the Cabinet Secretary already said, play a very important part and are very integral to the role of showcasing and commemorating the best of Scotland that we have to offer for here and also around the world. Scotland has a distinctive and rich history, and its heritage compensates all that and manages to bring it all together. It coordinates marketing and communication programmes to showcase this in the, our own country here and across the world. And our archaeology has shown that we have many different sites and discoveries that we've found that have been very much welcomed from Scotland and from other parts of the world. We must ensure, however, Deputy Presiding Officer, that we put the issue of encouraging more people to visit Scotland to see what we have on offer into some context. While there has been no change in the number of visitors to Scotland from the rest of the UK since 2009, there has been a reduction in overnight tourists in Scotland coming from other parts of the world, and that's dropped by 7% between 2007 and 2015. This decline in international visitors' numbers is something that we should all seek to address as we formulate Scotland's approach to tourism as we move forward. The wide participation in the Year of History, Heritage and our Guild has shown many organisations from the public and the private sector who are willing to embrace Civic Scotland, and that has been very encouraging. And I, Deputy Presiding Officer, pay tribute to these organisations who have made a huge difference by them actually being involved in their own communities, the length and breadth of Scotland, to develop and to ensure that attractions and the heritage is protected and sought after. That has encouraged individuals to come to these locations, and that continues to benefit communities the length and breadth of Scotland, and I very much welcome that. The bringing together of these creative industries, museums and historical trusts, and the tourism activities that take place and the agencies that are working together have resulted in a better structure and a more informed and defined approach than we had before. And these themed years have certainly engaged there. The theme has very much taken on board what we're trying to achieve, and we've brought all that together. And I think by doing that, it has ensured that we're going out to communities, we're going out to organisations, and they've taken on board many of the reports that have come forward to try and inspire their communities. And it's gone through education, it's gone through local authority, it's gone into trusts, and all of these different organisations are playing their part. By doing that, Deputy Presiding Officer, we then have the opportunity to ensure that the events that we have and the tourist sectors that we're trying to engage have a common theme and a thread that runs through that. And I think that's very important. I mean, many organisations talk about the golden thread that tries to bring things together. Well, this has certainly happened with these themed events. They have very much encapsulated all of that. And that has been of real benefit as we've moved forward. And we, as we've said in the past, we have a unique opportunity in our nation's past here in Scotland, and we should celebrate that, and many organisations, individuals do that. I also want to take the opportunity to recognise the integral role played by Visit Scotland in leading and coordinating efforts across Scotland's year, because that has proved to be the foundation that we've built on, and we've added to that as we've moved forward. We're incredibly lucky to have this organisation, as it works both on marketing Scotland internationally, but also providing information for tourists and visitors when they arrive here in Scotland. And that ensures that the themed year is encapsulated by them. We can offer them opportunities to go to different parts. If they come for a specific reason, we can then say, well, you can go and look at something else, or you may have an opportunity to develop and progress depending on how long they're here. And that gives opportunities across the piece for retail, for accommodation, for the sectors, for all of that to be involved. So I heartily welcome also the role that Historic Environment Scotland has to play in ensuring that we have a focused campaign as we move forward. Over the last 10 years, HES has spent £140.6 million repairing Scotland's historic environment to preserve it for the future. And that is so important. We have so much opportunity to look after the heritage that we have. And if we can fund it and make sure the resources are going into it, then it can be kept as we move forward. I am therefore so pleased to see and promote that this organisation has done so much, Deputy Presiding Officer, as I say, as we move forward. And to that end, it's extremely important that we ensure our tourism and the agencies that are necessary to ensure that we have all that are being funded and resourced adequately to ensure that they can market Scotland's heritage and that offers the rest of the world a real support. So by supporting these organisations and supporting Visit Scotland, we can step forward and we can showcase what we have and how we can develop it. So that's very important that we do all we can to ensure that they are receiving as much of the resource and funding as they need to. Presiding Officer, I think it is clear that there's widespread support across the Chamber for what we're trying to achieve today, and I look forward to hearing from many of the contributions that will take place during this debate, where individuals will have the opportunity, as I say, to promote their own sector or their own region or their own constituency. But as I said, the themed year has really shown us a real opportunity for visitors from abroad, but also from here at home, individuals who choose to click on to all the different organisations and events that are taking place. And I think that's very important. So in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, Visit Scotland and many of the organisations that ensure that the success we have encapsulated as we've gone forward, and I would commend that we commit to them and provide the necessary funding and resources to ensure that we can continue and they can continue to do their excellent work that has been regarded and we are looked upon across the world as a nation that has so much heritage, that has so much culture, that has so much opportunity. And these opportunities we have to ensure that are encapsulated and give us the chance to promote and market ourselves as a nation that has so much to offer. So thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I move the amendment in my name. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stewart. I now call Lewis MacDonald to speak to move Amendment 3748.1. Lewis MacDonald, a generous 6 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And we too do indeed celebrate Scotland's Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology. The physical artefacts of past generations are worth conserving, not just for their potential to generate visitor spend, which they do, but also because they are important in their own right. None of it, however, comes for free. Clearly, part of the Scottish Government's responsibility in 2017 is to ensure that the relevant agencies are able to make the necessary investments. And another part of that responsibility is to strengthen the working relationships in this field between agencies of central government and local councils. We know that Visit Scotland, the lead agency for promoting tourism as a sector, which was highlighted in Mr. Stewart's speech, we know that they are having once again to plan their annual marketing expenditure in terms with a real terms budget cut, confident though they are that they will be able to do so. Nonetheless, it's an important point. And Historic Environment Scotland, the product of a very recent merger between two quite distinct public agencies, is still seeking to find stability after a period of some difficulty with no additional funding in real terms. Of course.
Secretary. Well, is the member aware that in the budget that we have before us, the Historic Environment Scotland's budget will rise by 3.95% this year? And will he recognise that the written evidence from Visit Scotland to the budget was that they are pleased that its budget for the next financial year will be maintained at 43.9 million, exactly the same level as 2016? Now, that's a challenge, but in a tight budget settlement, that has been perceived and received as a good result for both the tourism sector and the heritage sector.
Lewis MacDonald.
I have no doubt that both those agencies will do their level best to ensure that they're delivering against their responsibilities in the face of those budget constraints which the Cabinet Secretary describes. But I think it's important in seeking to make the most of a themed year like this that we recognise that it doesn't happen by itself. It does require expenditure by public authorities. And while government has an overall role in promoting the themed year, it also has a role in ensuring that the resources that are required are there. And I turn to Scotland's councils because they are, of course, facing a substantial cut in their budgets for the next financial year, which can only add to the pressure on those aspects of Scotland's heritage sector for which they are responsible. And this Parliament now has powers. It has powers, for example, to consider a tourism levy, which councils might use to fund investment in visitor attractions and events, or indeed to vary income tax, which councils might use to support local public services. Those clearly will be matters for debate when we come to the budget debate on Thursday, rather than today. But if ministers do agree that a world-class heritage sector requires adequate resources, clearly part of the job of ministers is to ensure that they find the means to deliver those resources where they are required. Local authorities, of course, fund many of the museums and galleries, which are the first point of contact for many people with the culture and heritage of their local area. They're also key partners in supporting many of the destination management organisations and city centre business improvement districts, which pull together public and private sector partners to put their local areas on the visitor maps. Councils also employ archaeologists, and they have what, in the words of the current chair of their association, could be argued to be the biggest role in protecting Scotland's heritage. Among many other things, as Bruce Mann says, their job is to assess every planning application for its impact on the historic environment, to provide guidance to landowners and developers, to support community projects, and to lead large teams of volunteers in excavating sites. Mr. Mann reckons that he and his peers are responsible for managing 90% of Scotland's historic environment, around 290,000 sites, and last year alone generated over 1,600 projects across the country. That is just one of the council services which are vital if our historic environment is to be protected and which create added value of their own. Clearly, direct employment of a professional archaeologist may be at greater risk if a council is facing the prospect of having to make wide-ranging cuts in services, as many are likely to do this year. And indeed, despite the professional dedication of those archaeologists, the capacity of local councils to employ members of that profession has fallen in recent years as a result of funding issues. It's also important that councils are supported to make the capital investments needed to sustain the quality of the museums and galleries estate. Both the Scottish and UK governments can help here, can act as funders for projects such as refurbishment of existing buildings or development of new projects. And of course, the Heritage Lottery Fund has a very substantial role working with both central and local government agencies. And finally, in that field, European funding has been significant in many such projects over recent years. And the Minister, of course.
Cabinet Secretary.
I very much appreciate the point he makes, and quite often funding from Scottish Government can come either early in a project or late in the project, and particularly if you look at the amazing work that's been happening at the Kelvin Hall in particular, the funding from the Scottish Government already with the National Library's provision, but also in the roof prospect for that, also would free up additional space, and that's very important capital funding that complements the work of Glasgow Life and Glasgow City Council.
I absolutely recognise that, and referring to my own city, I recognise Scottish Government support with the refurbishment of Aberdeen Music Hall, but equally I will remind the Cabinet Secretary that there hasn't been the same support for the refurbishment of Aberdeen Art Gallery, and that again is part of that estate. I understand Government cannot support every project and have to make decisions and choices, but I think when we're looking at the context of those choices, we need to recognise that all these sources of funding can be significant. And many of Scotland's European structural funds for the current programme period have yet to be drawn down. I hope ministers can provide some certainty both about spending those currently available funds and also about future plans. Now, I think we all recognise that Historic Environment Scotland has faced some challenges in getting to grips with its very broad remit since it was created by the merger of Historic Scotland and the Royal Commission on the Ancient and Historic Monuments of Scotland. The success of that merger faced some real challenges as the new agency struggled to find its feet and to achieve effective partnership working with other public bodies. Clearly, it's important that public bodies are able to work together to solve problems before the point is reached where a significant site can be closed to visits by the public, as the Cabinet Secretary will recall happened at Maze Howe last year. Working together takes leadership. In this field, that leadership must come from Historic Environment Scotland, and it is now for the agency and its new Chief Executive, Alex Paterson, to provide such leadership and to move ahead in a spirit of active cooperation with local councils and other partners. But the challenge for government
I'm
is not just
that I... I'm to close very shortly. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The challenge for the Scottish Government, of course, is not just to support Historic Environment Scotland and other public agencies. It is also to ensure that all of our public visitor spaces, all the places that we know about that have been mentioned, are given support, whether they belong to government agencies directly, to local government, or indeed operate in the private or charitable sector. Many of our key sites here in Scotland are not...
I'm sorry, you will have to close. You've got an extra 2 minutes.
Indeed,
and
I move your
amendment, please.
Thank you very much, and thank you for your indulgence, and can I, with both the present and the future, as well as the past in mind, Presiding Officer, may I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much. Now move to the open debate. Speeches of 6 minutes. Colin Beattie, be followed by Alison Harris. Mr. Beattie.
Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to have the opportunity to speak today to highlight a topic in which I have my own keen interest, Scottish history. We live in a country with a unique and rich heritage, a heritage and history that have helped define who we are as a country. It's important that this year is dedicated to reflecting on our country's rich past, because knowledge about that past can help us form a better future. While looking at our country and reflecting on its history is something we should constantly do, regardless of the year, Visit Scotland has dedicated 2017 to the theme Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology, aims to promote our country, celebrate its history, heritage and archaeology, inspire Scottish citizens and visitors to engage with their country, collaborate with the tourism sector in regards to this theme, and encourage businesses to make the most of this year through seizing a hold of opportunities to expand themselves. Now, I believe this is a great concept that will be beneficial to our country and can effectively contribute to its continued growth and success. Statistically, tourism in the year 2015 contributed £11 billion to Scotland's economy. Historic Environment Scotland, the lead public body dedicated to the care of the historical environment in Scotland, contributes £2.3 billion to the national gross value added, while supporting thousands of jobs. So you see, history is not something that is ever over. It continues to grow as time goes on, drawing more and more people towards it. People want to know about Scotland. They want to understand its unique beauty and culture. And it's this interest that continues to sustain us financially as a country and intellectually as human beings. History is an interesting concept because the older we get, the more of it we've lived through. History contains the remnants of our ancestors, their lives, their sorrows, their joys. It teaches us about who they were, which allows us a better insight into who we are. For we are nothing without our past, and they are our past. A quote on Visit Scotland's webpage says, "We've been preparing for 2017 for centuries." Indeed, we have been. History can be found everywhere, in every town, in every constituency, in every corner of Scotland and the world. Within my constituency, there lies Dalkeith Country Park, a popular park marked by centuries of history. The woodlands found in the park are hundreds of years old themselves, but this beautiful park is also marked by the existence of the Dalkeith Palace. Unfortunately, this building is no longer open to public visits, but the history that surrounds it is truly fascinating. Completed in the year 1711, the current building was the home of the first Duchess of Buccleuch. The Duchess commissioned the architect James Smith to build a palace after the manner of the Het Loo Palace in the Netherlands. But while the building that can still be seen standing in the park is beautiful and full of interesting stories, the historical nature of this location dates back long before its time. Dating before the 12th century, the ground on which the palace now stands was occupied by Dalkeith Castle. Being passed from the Grahams to the Douglases, the building lasted until the year 1547. In that year, the English invaded and destroyed the castle, leaving it in ruins until the year 1575, when James Douglas, 4th Earl of Morton, ordered a new castle to be built in its place. And that castle remained until the widowed Duchess Anne Scott ordered the palace to be built as we can see it today. And it's remarkable to consider the rich history of this palace. These grounds have been walked by important figures, including Margaret Tudor, Charles I, Bonnie Prince Charlie, King George IV, and Queen Victoria. And it's this history on these beautiful grounds that attracts a substantial number of visitors every year. But the history within my constituency doesn't stop at a palace. Every 21 years in the honest town of Musselburgh, people line the streets to watch the riding of the marches. In fact, this special riding took place last year, so if you missed that spectacle, you'll have to wait for another 20 years. But if you can't bring yourself to wait that long, you can always attend the yearly festival that's still held. One of the most ancient ceremonies in the UK, the March Riding, commemorates the marking of the borough's ancient boundaries. The tradition is believed to have begun in the 15th century, although it was first recorded in 1682. In ancient times, it's said that the area might have suffered from years of raidings, and the marches were created to prevent the land from English encroachment. But while parts of the tradition have changed over the years, some things remain the same. A proclamation is still made at the Mercat Cross, followed by the march of a town champion, turf cutter, turf cutter's assistant, squires and halberdiers to the boundary stations found round the town. At these locations, a sod of turf is cut and the cry is made, "It's our ain." Scotland's our country, rich in history, full of culture, unmistakably ours. Our past is there to learn from, to teach children, to remember. The past can change the future, but if we don't learn about it, there's little hope for a future. Not long ago, I was invited to speak by the National Library, the topic being 17th century Scottish history. Of course, I was thrilled to be given the opportunity due to my keen interest in history and my love of books. I focused the majority of my talk on the events that resulted in perhaps one of the greatest bloodlettings in Scottish history. It's less well known that the so-called English Civil War resulted in the deaths of 237,000 Scots out of a population of 1 million. Truly horrific statistics. But I would like to focus on two specific people of interest from this century.
You'll have to draw to a conclusion, not focus on two, please.
Well, in that case, I'll skip past the two specific people of interest. But I will mention, the Scottish Parliament itself has interesting history as well. And on the 1st of April 1690, the last order by the Parliament for the torture of an individual was passed in this Parliament. For the good old days. So as we join with Visit Scotland in celebrating our heritage, history and archaeology, it's important for us to remember that Scotland is not only our past, but our present and future as well. It's up to us to make it the best it can be. The history of tomorrow is today, and it's my belief that this year will provide the world with an opportunity to see Scotland for what it truly is, a place of greatness, of learning, of opportunity, of growth, of strength and of hope. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call Alison Harris to be followed by Stuart Stevenson. Ms. Harris, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm delighted that 2017 has been designated as the Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology. Our country has so much to show in every one of these areas in a way that few others can match. We have a long history with much visual evidence still remaining, from Scarabray to standing stones to castles by the dozen, imposing homes and evidence that our country played in forging the Industrial Revolution. Our heritage is one that has been nurtured through the generations. We live in a country that values its past. Such is the wealth of history that we can see in Scotland today. I hope the Chamber will understand if I concentrate for reasons of time on the history on my own doorstep. Living as I do in Falkirk, I could easily fill a number of speeches with the history, heritage and archaeology of a town that has played such an important part in the history of Scotland. Long before it was the scene of two pivotal battles, the Romans found that Falkirk was just about as far into Scotland as they wanted to go. In 142 AD, the Emperor Antoninus Pius ordered the building of a wall across Scotland from Carndean near Bonnes to Old Kilpatrick. Yes, there were Roman forts further north, but by and large, the Antonine Wall was the northern border of the Roman Empire. A wall of turf on a stone base with a deep ditch in front of it. A good idea of how imposing the wall was can be gained at various points along its length, including Callander Park in Falkirk. Stone and timber forts every 2 miles, including one at Rough Castle near Bonnybridge, which today gives a good understanding of what forts were like. However, the wall was barely finished when the Romans decided to withdraw back behind Hadrian's Wall. In the Middle Ages, the Roman origins largely forgotten, the wall was called Graham's Dyke, a fact remembered today in street names in Bowness and Lauriston. In Victorian times and into the 20th century, further archaeology was carried out, largely by the Glasgow Archaeological Society, who unearthed many of the remains that today tell the story of this fascinating period of our history. Of course, Deputy Presiding Officer, no self-respecting part of Scotland is complete without a good castle, and even better if it was built in the shape of a boat. Built in the 15th century, knocked about a bit by Cromwell, Blackness Castle on the southern shore of the Firth of Forth juts out into the Forth in the shape of a stone boat, complete with a bow and stern. Its beauty and unusual design has made it a popular venue from filmmakers such as Franco Zeffirelli for his 1990 Hamlet, or the BBC series Ivanhoe, and the 2008 sci-fi film Doomsday. Deputy Presiding Officer, I am proud that my town was at the centre of the creation of modern industrial Scotland. The Forth and Clyde Canal, reopened as part of the Millennium Link, was the original motorway of central Scotland. Taking goods from coast to coast and later by means of additional canals enabled goods and passengers to flow between our two largest cities and all points in between. Its waters were used to demonstrate the world's first practical steamboat, the Charlotte Dundas, built in Grangemouth. The canals and viaducts were built by human endeavour with the limited equipment of the day. Interestingly, one of the men who came from Ireland to work in the canal was William Burke. He settled in Madison near Falkirk before meeting up with fellow Irishman William Hare, who also was working on the cutting of the canal. Happily, with the exception of Burke and Hare, those who came with them from Ireland during this period had contributed to our heritage in a much more positive way. Today, a new wonder, the Falkirk Wheel, stands joining the Forth and Clyde and the Union Canals, and the Kelpies remind us of the role that heavy horses played in pulling much of the canal traffic. The canals made Falkirk an ideal site for the developing industries of the mid-18th century, and the establishment of Carron Ironworks in 1759 really put Falkirk on the map. The largest ironworks in Europe, visited by Robert Burns and Benjamin Franklin. Whether it was the famous carronades of the Royal Navy or guns that defended the Alamo, to the latter production of such items such as stoves and pillar boxes, Carron was a byword for quality. Today, the gatehouse remains to remind us of this giant part of our industrial past. Deputy Presiding Officer, I wish I had more time to tell the chamber of Callender House in the centre of Falkirk, of the Pineapple at Dunmore, of Keneal House in Bowness, where James Watt worked in his first steam engine, of the Community Heritage Centre in Grangemouth, of the hangars which still stand witness to the site of the Central Scotland Airport, which opened in Grangemouth in 1939, of the Bowness Motor Museum, of the Bowness Steam Railway, and of the local individuals who played such a part not only in building the story of Scotland, but indeed the wider world.
Really is in her last minute.
Sorry. I will finish by applauding all the groups, public agencies and private individuals who keep our history and heritage alive and make Scotland such a great place to visit. To do so, they need support in both funding and resources. And recognising that, this afternoon I shall be supporting the Conservative amendment. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think for my next trip round Scotland, I call Stuart Stevenson to be followed by Lane Smith.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I stand before you as a self-confessed geek, and my geekness is my hobby as a genealogist. That's something I took up some 50 years ago. I've just recently completed a postgraduate certificate in genealogical, paleographic and heraldic studies, which I took online at the University of South Clyde. I absolutely commend their courses to anyone with an interest in the subject. Now, in Scotland, we have world-leading access to our family history information, and that's something that tens of millions of people across the world who have a familial connection to Scotland I know use. And of course, many of these people who research their own family history at a distance end up coming to Scotland. When I visit the Scotland's People's Centre at number 2 Princes Street, I regularly hear the helpful and informed staff taking people from across the world through how to find their family history records for their own ancestors. You hear the gentle whoops of joy as Granny McGregor is finally found. Now, my family, like probably most families, is full of migration. Besides my great-great-grandfather Archibald Stuart, who left Scotland in 1853 for Canada at the age of 64 after being widowed, I've identified 13 further sets of relatives of his generation and their descendants who've migrated to Canada, the USA, Ceylon, Australia and New Zealand. And in my wife's family, I've identified 12 migration events in the same period of time. And it continues to this day with nephews and nieces that we have who are long-term residents in Sweden, Denmark, and Australia. Plus, I've got a more distant connection. The brother of the 5 greats-grandfather of my nephew's fiancée who was convicted of stealing a coat in 1830 and travelled at government expense to Australia. And for George Adam, I actually have people who emigrated as far away as Paisley. So all of us are likely to have relatives out there who are interested in what we do in Scotland and maintain an active interest in their own history here. The huge Scottish diaspora are part of us and we are part of them. And for them, this year is an opportunity for us to move their interest up and increase their attachment to the mother country to another level. The refresh of the Scotland's People website has given even better access to a wide range of family history data. New data has just been added, and that's a key part of drawing our international cousins in. When you visit the historic building lurking behind the Duke of Wellington statue, they get the expert advice that they're looking for, and it can be the highlight of a visit for many people who come to Scotland. But it isn't just people who are employed professionally who matter. There are family history societies right across Scotland, volunteers regularly going out to record the inscriptions from gravestones and publishing the results. About 18 months ago, bought the book of inscriptions of the new Colton Cemetery. It's about 400 metres behind you, presiding officer, from the Scottish Genealogical Society. And that helped me track down three particular family members. The Fife Family History Society's book of criminals helped me solve another problem in somebody else's family tree, not, of course, in my own. And in Aberdeen, we have the massive resources of the Aberdeen and North East Scotland Family History Society, and they've members right across the world, well over 10,000 members. And in my constituency, the Family History Society of Buchan does likewise for local data. To know your own family history is to better understand yourself. Now, to be particular and personal, I have more politicians in my family than I ever thought that I would actually have. A Canadian senator, Keith Laird, who's a third cousin. He was a legal partner of Paul Martin Sr., who was the father of a Canadian prime minister. An MP in New South Wales, Alexander Berry, who's a cousin four times removed, who became wealthy 150 years ago by employing convicts. He subsequently endowed a chair at St Andrews University that continues to this day. Lord James Stevenson, my father's first cousin, who chaired the Empire Exhibition Committee in the 1920s and was responsible for the building of the first Wembley Stadium. And I really don't have time. And my great-uncle, Alex Stevenson...
I don't think he'd be friendly somehow.
Lord Provost in this city, who ensured that the statues to Robert De Bruce and William Wallace were installed on either side of the entrance into Edinburgh Castle in 1929. The attraction of genealogy, and the Cabinet Secretary referred to it, is one of the branches of history and one that is intensely personal. And of course, it's one where you will never finish your research. Now, that means, of course, there's the opportunity for lots of repeat visits for people. But of course, you sometimes discover what today would be bad news, but when it's 200 years ago, it's merely interesting. In a parish record of a child's birth, I once saw the phrase, conceived in ante-nuptial fornication. Now, if that was my parent, that might be one thing, but 200 years ago, it was fascinating because it's redolent of another age.
And there,
now,
I'm afraid
you
must...
I do have to close now, Presiding
Please conclude.
Officer. To go back to the National Records of Scotland to read the 200 pages of court papers, 17 recognitions, etc., of the young man who stole a coat from Leith Walk House in August 1830 and got a free trip to Australia for his pains.
Thank you very much. I'm now enlightened to your family. I call Elaine Smith to be followed by Claire Adamson, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'm sure we can all agree that Scotland's heritage is vital to our economy, our culture and the history that we'll pass on to the next generation. As such, the safekeeping of our heritage is a responsibility we should take seriously. And to do that, we need to recognise that adequate funding, including for local government, is essential. So whilst I do support the government's motion, I also support Labour's amendment today. Presiding Officer, an often ignored and fundamental aspect of our heritage is workers' struggle. and the social artefacts that men and women in our industrial areas left behind can help inform future generations of that struggle and the working class background that many of us grew up with. The mines, the steelworks, the factories of the industrial belt built our prosperity as a nation, and those who worked there deserve to be remembered. I understand that in May, the Festival of Museums will begin with events planned across Scotland, encouraging visitors to see our heritage. Unfortunately, we're privileged in central Scotland to have great examples of workers' heritage attractions, including in my own hometown of Coatbridge. Summerlee Heritage Museum was originally planned and built by Monklands District Council, and it's based around the site of a 19th century ironworks, and entry to it is free. I used to actually be able to boast that Coatbridge had the only working trams left in Scotland, as the museum has a tramway and it's operated by volunteers and it takes visitors to the model drift mine and cottages. And the mine itself is extremely well done. It gives a sense of what it must have been like to toil underground, never seeing the sun and breathing in the dust and the dirt and the fumes. And the guides who take you down talk about the miners through the ages, the horrendous working conditions, the industrial diseases and the ailments. And indeed, one of the model miner figures shows clearly the extent of miner's tattoo, which was a blue scarring caused by coal getting into cuts and abrasions. And the cottages, they show the living conditions throughout the ages from the 1840s to the 1980s. And in the main hall of the museum, you can see social history and artefacts, including trade union banners and election posters, such as the one for Jenny Lee. And outside, there is the remains of the Monkland Canal with a replica of the Vulcan, the world's very first iron-hulled vessel, and there's also a playground for young ones outside. Now, over the years, I've taken many visitors from home and abroad to this fantastic museum to learn about the toil and togetherness that helped to build Britain throughout the Industrial Revolution and beyond. However, one of my most memorable was actually with Dr. Alida Guevara, the daughter of Shea, who was staying with me for a few days in Coatbridge. And she was extremely impressed with the museum, but, presiding officer, she particularly enjoyed having a shot on the flying fox in the playground area, and I must say that memory of her on that flying fox certainly lives with me. I think we should recognise the achievement of a small Labour council in taking on such an innovative and forward-thinking project such as Summerlee and leaving a legacy for future generations. Now, I've said before that I don't imagine holidaymakers flocking en masse to the Costa Cote Bridge, but I would highly recommend that visitors do come to see Summerlee as well as Drumpellier Country Park and the Time Capsule. It's important to highlight places, but also to remember people, I think, who are part of our history and heritage. And I noticed recently the Scotswoman Project, which has been set up to remember and celebrate the life and work of Scottish women who have been too often overlooked. And I want to take this opportunity today to promote Janet Hamilton, who is a great poet who detailed the changing shape and culture of her native Lang Loan in Coatbridge, and indeed there is a monument to Janet Hamilton there. And since we have a little bit of... certainly.
Cabinet Secretary. The member is quite right that we need to do more in Scotland to celebrate women and our heritage, and would she help encourage people to promote the heritage plaques run by Heritage Environment Scotland, where we're particularly keen to get women that have forged Scotland's history commemorated right across Scotland? Eileen Smith.
Well, I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that intervention. Perhaps we can consider Janet Hamilton, if I might just briefly. And I think we're still in January, so I think it's relevant to just say that she was born the year before he died. Janet Hamilton cited Robert Burns amongst her greatest influences, and she wrote a poem for the centenary of his birth, and she recited it at the Burns Centenary Festival in Dumfries in 1859. And I'll share the first verse with you, but I hope you'll forgive my delivery. I have a bit of a cold. O bard beloved, as pilgrims to thy shrine, with song and gift we come our vows to pay. The growing fame of 100 years is thine, and lands and nations hail thy natal day. Janet Hamilton, presiding officer, also dedicated one of her published volumes of poetry, 1868 Poems and Ballads, to her brothers, the men of the working classes. And I think women like Janet documented the story of Scotland and its people, their loves, their losses, their community and their solidarity. So it is important to remember them. Could I briefly mention in my last few seconds the heritage of those who moved to this country looking for a better life, including some of my own ancestors. In particular, the Irish community in Scotland helped to lay the foundations of many of our great towns and cities. They made a home here, they built churches, they raised children who went on to become doctors, builders, teachers and engineers. And their story is one reflected throughout many parts of Scotland. It's a story of triumph in the face of adversity and success of hard work across the generations. And in Coatbridge, we celebrate that heritage with an annual St Patrick's Day festival that lasts for 2 weeks, celebrating all aspects of Irish culture and its legacy and attracting visitors from home and abroad. And I'm sure all of you would be welcome to come along to that this year. It's a great example of the sort of heritage we should be championing in Scotland, cross-community, cooperative and constructive. And just to finish, can I say we should reflect the mixed palette that makes Scotland the place we all love, and we must invest both in education and upkeep. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call Claire Adamson to be followed by Liam MacArthur. Ms Adamson, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm very glad to rise and speak in this debate this afternoon. The opportunity to talk about the constituency of Motherwell Militias and its heritage is one I truly relish. My first home was in North Motherwell, adjacent to Strathclyde Country Park. And as a youngster, I was fascinated by the Roman remains in the park. It is believed that the Romans came to Motherwell area in 140 AD. A garrison of some 600 soldiers were based overlooking the South Calder Water. A bathhouse was discovered during the landscaping of the park in the 1970s, revealing a carved drain cover, which is thought to be one of the best in Europe. It's now housed in a museum in London, so it may be more than those chessmen that we're seeking to have returned. The area is now protected for wildlife, which I'm sure would have been interest to our Year of Natural Heritage, so further investigations aren't possible at the moment. If you're interested, you may want to consult my colleague Gordon MacDonald, who I believe was involved in some of the research while studying archaeology. I was a mere wee lassie at the time. The bathhouse is the only standing stone remains of its type in Scotland. It's open freely to the public, making it an attraction to children, dog walkers and tourists alike. More recently, artefacts from the lost medieval village of Cadzow were found near the M74 during the excavations for the current motorway works near the Raith interchange. I was delighted to be able to attend the unveiling of the finds at the edge of the motorway bordering the country park, along with then Transport Minister Keith Brown. The finds included two structures, coins and pieces of pottery, and not very PC for current modern Scotland, smoking pipes. Archaeologists believe they may be more than 1,000 years old and could finally identify the location of the lost village of Cadzow. It was a name given to the community on the edge of the River Clyde at this location until 1445. The artefacts and the structures were uncovered close to a memorial stone marking the former position of the 1,000-year-old Netherton Cross, one of the earliest symbols of Christianity and one of the most valuable pre-Norman Christian relics in Scotland. Warren Bailey from Garda Archaeology at the time said, medieval remains rarely survive in industrial centres such as Glasgow due to widespread industrialisation of the 19th century, including mining, road and housing construction. Very few medieval settlements have survived, so we're delighted to recover and record such a rare and interesting piece of Scottish history. And there is no doubt that Lanarkshire has been ravaged by the industrial era in terms of some of our most valuable buildings. In my own area, very few of the old houses currently remain, most of them having to be destroyed because of undermining. Also included in this find was a lead pistol shot. It was on the floor of one of the structures, and it's possible evidence that an officer involved in the Battle of Bothwell Bridge in 1679 may have taken cover in the then ruins of the buildings at Netherton. And that brings me to a next tale of intrigue and interest. Presiding Officer, you will know that I love my dog Coco and that I really enjoy a walk with her in Greenhead Moss and Campus Nethin. And one of the most mysterious stories in the area was the discovery of a partially preserved body of a man in the peat bog moss in the 1930s. The remains consisted of decayed fragments of human bones, clothes in a wool jacket, shoes, stockings and a cap. And a report on the finds in the Transactions of the Glasgow Archaeological Society concluded, laid upon the impoverished stretcher, The body was apparently carried over a considerable stretch of desolate bog and disposed of furtively. The burial is unconsecrated ground and suggests a case of suicide, yet the slashed bonnet, the shoe indicating sword thrusts, seem to weaken the conjecture. It cannot be stated definitely whether the killing episode was connected with the fighting induced by the religious disturbances prevalent in the district in the later part of the 17th century, nor can it be affirmed whether the victim was a military or civilian person. He did not belong to the very lowest grade of society. If a royalist, he was more likely to have been a foot soldier. A dragoon in uniform would wear boots, not shoes, and his equipment, as described in ancient records, was apparently of better quality and greater elaboration than those discovered. If the victim was a Covenanter, he may have been cut off unbeknown to his companions, and his body, bearing wounds to the neck and the foot, carried away secretly and probably in darkness by his aggressors and given a hurried burial. The dating of the body was done using a costume expert, Mrs. Helen Bennett, at the National Museum of Antiquities. And just like the chessmen and the drain cover, this story also involves a request for return, because the Central Community Council in Wishaw have been petitioning the Kelvin Grove Museum to have at least part or the whole remains returned so that they can be interred at the Covenanter's monument on Greenhead Moss. Presiding officer, Motherwell is at the heart of Scottish history, so much so it inspired one of the world's greatest historians in Tom Devine. So I would recommend everybody to come to Motherwell, surrounded by our history, surrounded by castles, by the historic town of Lanark and its links to William Wallace, and New Lanark as well. The whole of Scottish history is there, including political history, as we did have the first SNP MP in 1945.
I call Liam MacArthur to be followed by Bruce Crawford.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It has a bit of a feel of a balloon debate this afternoon. It will come as no surprise to anyone fortunate enough to have watched the BBC series Ancient Orkney recently that I wholeheartedly welcome this afternoon's debate. Indeed, I feel moved to declare a declaration of interest on behalf of my entire constituency. Instead, I will offer my strong support for the Cabinet Secretary's motion. And likewise, I believe the amendments from Alexander Stewart and Lewis MacDonald sensibly highlight the partnership approach as well as the resources that I think are essential in making a success of this year of history, heritage and archaeology. And this is something I want to return to shortly, drawing on a particular example in Orkney, in the Orkney context, that perhaps underscores the work that still needs to be done to match the very laudable sentiments set out in the government's motion more consistently with reality on the ground. But the Cabinet Secretary is certainly right to point out to the success of the themed years. They have provided an opportunity to bring together different aspects of national life in Scotland, celebrate them, and promote them to a wider audience. Each play to our strengths, but recognise the risks inherent in resting on our laurels. History, heritage, and archaeology fit the bill perfectly and very much deserve their time in the spotlight. I hope over the coming year that more people will come to recognise and value what it is that Scotland as a whole has to offer, and the extent to which every community right across the country has a part to play in telling that story as well as their own story. Archaeology, heritage and history are fundamentally important, of course, in shaping our identity through increasing our understanding of the people of the past, but also through promoting popular visitor and local interest. In Orkney, what has been striking over the years is the extent to which local communities themselves often provide the driving force. Sandy Heritage Trust is only one example of where the enthusiasm, the commitment, the local knowledge of people in that community, with the input of experienced archaeologists and other specialists, have led to wonderful discoveries and a much clearer picture of the past. Similar groups exist around Orkney and nationwide, as acknowledged by the Cabinet Secretary in her remarks. Without them, we would have nothing like the understanding we currently do of our history and heritage. The same, of course, can be said of the network of local rangers who certainly do a fabulous job in Orkney and, I dare say, across the country as well. This needs supporting, however. Building capacity at a local level is vital, not just the extension of powers of Historic Environment Scotland at the centre. It requires supporting local, regional archaeologists under threat in a number of places across Scotland, as I understand it. And in passing, I note that the current archaeology strategy for Scotland has been criticised in some quarters for perhaps underplaying the role of universities in both research and education. This strikes me as slightly counterintuitive, but I would hope the Cabinet Secretary may agree to investigate that and see what more can be done to set this out more clearly. And as I mentioned in my earlier exchange with the Cabinet Secretary, we are hugely fortunate in Scotland to have six World Heritage sites recognised by UNESCO as having global cultural and natural heritage significance. Obviously, the heart of Neolithic Orkney has been the one grabbing the headlines of late, thanks to Neil Oliver and co. And there is no doubt that Nick Card and his team deserve enormous credit for the astonishing work they are doing at the Nessa Brogga. It's really been fascinating to witness firsthand the challenging of long-held assumptions about the Neolithic age based on what is being unearthed at the Ness. Some of us, Deputy Presiding Officer, take quiet satisfaction, indeed vindication, at proof of Orkney's place at the centre of civilisation. Disappointingly, however, these remarkable finds at the Ness, the way in which they've captured the public imagination and generated interest in Orkney as well as in archaeology more generally, have coincided with what I believe was a ludicrous decision by Historic Environment Scotland, first to close and then subsequently to limit access to one of the jewels in the Crown, Maze Howe. I think Fiona Hislop knows and I suspect probably shares my concerns about what happened. This, though, illustrates where the aspirations underpinning the Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology are still some distance from realising consistently across the ground. I welcome the agreement by HESI's Chief Executive Alec Patterson to visit Orkney next week to meet with stakeholders, including representatives of the local tourism industry, to discuss possible solutions. The urgency of those talks should not be underestimated. We need action in the short term, not least to avoid squandering the benefits of the current focus there is on Orkney. We cannot afford to risk raising expectations on the one hand and then fail to deliver for potential visitors on the other. But we also need a more ambitious long-term solution. It makes no sense at all to serve our world-class heritage sites with anything less than world-class infrastructure and facilities. Yet that is what is happening present in this instance. What more fitting legacy could there be for the Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology than a firm commitment by the government, its agencies and local partners to deliver the sort of World Heritage Gateway in Orkney that will do justice to the internationally renowned sites? I very much hope the Cabinet Secretary agrees on that point. Before concluding, Deputy Presiding Officer, let me raise one more example where I think the year ahead could be used to make progress both in developing interest and understanding of our heritage alongside growing an increasingly important segment of the tourism sector in Scotland. Scapa Flow's decisive role in both World Wars puts Orkney in a special position when it comes to attracting the growing numbers of people with a passion for military history. The Jutland centenary last year, the commemorations around that, provided ample evidence of this fact. As more of those with lived experience of the wars pass away, we can only expect the interest in what they went through to increase and intensify. This is something that should be recognised and reflected in whatever is planned for the rest of the year ahead. Deputy Presiding Officer, I warmly welcome the fact that 2017 is to be the Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology. As in past years, however, the challenge will be to ensure that it leaves a positive and a lasting legacy. And on that basis, I hope Fiona Hislop will reflect on the areas that I've identified and respond positively in due course. Thank you.
I call Bruce Crawford to be followed by Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Despite all of the troubled news that seems to be rolling around the world early in 2017, at least one domestic agenda to get excited about. That is, of course, our subject for debate today on the history, heritage and archaeology. And no wonder, like the Cabinet Secretary, I agree, it is something to get excited about, given the outstanding success of the two previous themed years. Last year's focus on innovation, architecture and design saw Scottish projects featured across the world. In 2015, the Year of Food and Drink allowed Scottish produce to be noticed on the international stage, resulting in a visitor spend of almost £1 billion on food and drink, the highest ever recorded. Both 2015 and 2016 were a phenomenal success for Scotland, and I have every confidence 2017 will be another fabulous year for our country and for Stirling to showcase what we have to offer. I would say to Claire Addison that actually my constituency of Stirling is at the heart of Scotland's history and heritage. Indeed, the city of Stirling itself was built on history, with our streets, our homes, schools and businesses clustered around that magnificent fortress castle and medieval old town. Now, Stirling also played a role in Scotland's Roman history, as Alison will have been pleased to note, with remnants of an old Roman road running alongside Stirling Golf Club. But of course, Stirling heritage and history, like many other places, goes back much further than that. Hard to believe, I wasn't around at the time, but in 5000 BC, a huge tsunami hit Stirling, leaving behind whale bones on the Carse, which nowadays hosts one of the busiest roads in Stirlingshire. And the town of Callander is not just famous for its links with Rob Roy, but also has the home to a Neolithic site, including the Auchinleck Cairn, at 322 metres in length, the longest burial ground in the United Kingdom. So, Presiding Officer, looking forward, what does Stirling have to offer this year of history, heritage and archaeology? First off, we're home to the wonderful Stirling Castle. It was once the palace to some of Scotland's most notable kings and queens. And following Historic Scotland's £12 million palace project, the magnificent James IV Renaissance Palace was returned to how it had looked in the 1540s. And since this renovation, Stirling has welcomed around 460,000 visitors a year to its castle. And last year, deservedly, was named Scotland's best visitor attraction. So Edinburgh, eat your heart out. I would encourage anyone who has yet to visit the castle to do so. It's really worth a look. My constituency is also home to Cambus Kenneth Abbey and Inchmahome Priory, found on the island of Lake of Menteith. It was, of course, in Cambus Kenneth that the nobility and clergy of Scotland swore fealty to David Bruce as the heir to King Robert in 1326 at the first Parliament to include representatives of the boroughs, a real step forward for democracy in Scotland. And Inchmahome played host to many important figures throughout Scotland's history, including Robert the Bruce and, of course, Mary Queen of Scots, who found refuge on the island. Now, the island's also the burial place to a significant political figure from Scotland's past, Robert Bontine Cunningham Graham, who was a founder member of both the Scottish Labour Party and the National Party of Scotland. It's little known that the island is his burial place, and while I've earlier praised Historic Scotland, I'm a critical friend of the organisation here, and I agree with Elaine Smith, we need to do perhaps more to remember our people. There's a fantastic opportunity at the lake to do a lot more to recognise this colourful and flamboyant character from our past. Stirling's also fortunate enough to have the wonderful resource of the Stirling Art Gallery and Museum, as well as being home to the renowned battlefields of the Scottish Wars of Independence at Stirling Bridge in Bannockburn. The state-of-the-art visitor centre at the site of the Battle of Bannockburn has brought an abundance of new visitors to the area, benefiting both locals and residents and businesses alike. But we really need to complete the telling of the history of Stirling by getting the planned magnificent memorial statue to William Wallace and Andrew de Moray erected at the site of the Stirling Bridge battle. Talking of Wallace, I was privileged to host the Visit Scotland's reception just last week to help showcase how this year of history, heritage and archaeology can be realised in the best possible way for Scotland. And one thing that really did capture my imagination the night was the new virtual reality app which is being developed by Visit Scotland. Using the app to fly around the majestic Wallace Monument was truly an incredible experience and showed me very strongly the power of visual reality for the future. It is a fantastic tool for potential visitors to explore our history, our landscape, the heritage of Scotland, encouraging them to travel here. And recently, I was delighted that the Cabinet Secretary announced that Doon Castle will be one of the sites across Scotland, receiving a portion of the £6.6 million of funding to support conservation, repair and visitor facilities. Doon Castle was obviously boosted visitor numbers in Scotland after featuring in the Outlander TV series, who who my very excitable staff have got to tell me, informed me, were filming nearby in the Parliament recently. Stirling has such a wealth of history, in fact, so much so, if it happened in Scotland, then Stirling was probably involved somehow. I'm therefore, like the Cabinet Secretary, incredibly excited to see what the Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology will bring. Thank you.
Time is creeping up on us now, so if I could ask the remaining speakers to stick to 6 minutes. Oliver Mundell, followed by Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and please accept my apologies in advance for joining many members in this chamber today and sounding a bit like a Visit Scotland advert. And whilst I can't compete with Elaine Smith and Costa Coatbridge, I would feel a bit remiss if I wasn't doing my bit to talk up the Solway Riviera. It is the part of the world that I know best and know the most about, but I also believe it is, Dumfriesshire is one of our most diverse and distinguished parts of Scotland. And I very much welcome the opportunity to take part in a debate in this chamber where we're all united in talking up communities the length and breadth of our country. For its part, Dumfriesshire is best known as the land of Burns, GM Barry, and of course, Bruce. Indeed, Deputy Presiding Officer, it does not matter what era or area of Scottish national life and history you look at, the connections can be seen in every town, village and settlement that I represent. From the Covenanters to World War commanders, from the great border reavers to our poets, from kings to simple country folk living life as they've always done, our heritage is in abundance. In particular, I think of Langham Common Riding, which still takes place every year and is a sight to behold, with people lining the streets as the townsfolk and those nearby ride out and mark the boundaries of the land, making new the traditions of the past and keeping our history alive. I hope, having recently taken up horse riding, that I will be able to join them this year. I also think of the old blacksmith shop at Gretna Green, which has become famous the world over as a place where marriage ceremonies take place and all of the history wrapped up in that. And also of more recent history, just down the road at the Devil's Porridge Museum, which has recently reopened on a new purpose-built site in Eastriggs, commemorating the Great War and the efforts of tens of thousands of women who worked at the munitions factory at HM Gretna. And I do want to take this opportunity to pay thanks and tribute to the incredible work of members of the community who put in so much time and effort to ensure that that story is told and given justice. And I think as we look at the events planned across the year, it's so encouraging and positive to see grassroots involvement in those projects and see people across Scotland taking part. Going further back in my own constituency, we have Lochmaben Castle linked to Robert the Bruce, and of course Colaverick Castle on the Solway Estuary, or should I say Riviera, near Dumfries, which has become not only a monument to our past, but a great site for bird watchers and nature enthusiasts. Further up north, up in Upper Nithsdale, we now see the Croic multiverse in full swing just outside Sanker, which not only recognises the impact and heritage that mining has had in that area, but it also creates a new attraction out of something old and once again opens up a destination for visitors from further afield. I mentioned Burns before, and you cannot visit the Dumfriesshire constituency without finding yourself on the Burns Trail, whether that be visiting his home in Dumfries, the mausoleum where he's buried at St Michael's Kirkyard, his farm at Ellisland, or the Brow Well just outside Ruthwell. We also, of course, going further back, have some very interesting and archaeological history, which has recently come to light at Burnswark Hill, just outside Ecclefechan, which was the site of a Roman battle. And the distinctive flat-top hill where those events took place can be seen for miles around, and I would encourage anyone with an interest to take a further look at that. And of course, Just this week, we've heard once again the remarkable story of Thomas Telford, who was born in Westerkirk, with a book on his life featuring as Radio 4's Book of the Week. There is so much to cover and so much heritage right on our doorstep. I believe it's for all of us to encourage people to take advantage of those opportunities and to sell our country, not just to our fellow countrymen and women, but those around the world. And I commend the efforts of Visit Scotland and others in highlighting our cultural assets. However, I think we cannot afford to be complacent. And on a more substantive point, I would encourage ministers and the Scottish Government to do all that they can to make sure that our tourist industry more generally feels as supported as possible and to help ensure that we have the right mix of skills. And I look particularly at projects taken forward by Dumfries and Galloway College that are making sure that that's the case in our own local economy. And I'd also very strongly believe it's about giving the New South of Scotland Enterprise Agency the remit to help our tourist businesses make the most of our culture and heritage and ensure that people are well supported to take their ambitions forward. And I would like to thank, in conclusion, the Scottish Government again for bringing forward this debate and giving me the opportunity to highlight some of the visitor destinations and areas of interest in my own constituency. Thank you.
Gillian Martin, to be followed by Maurice Corey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome this debate on celebrating our past, because Scotland's a nation built on history and it forms a great part of our appeal as a tourist destination, as we've been hearing from all the speakers today. The contributions of my colleagues today have inspired me to get out more and see more of the main country. Scotland's history is loaded with great academic, cultural, philosophical and literary achievements, and in my constituency of Aberdeenshire East, we've more than our fair share of those. It's always bewildered me that more isn't made of our corner of the country in the tourism portfolio. And I, at the weekend, I had a wee go at BuzzFeed for their meeting Slane's Castle near Cruden Bay, when they had an article on 25 Scottish locations that could easily be in Game of Thrones. Mine wasn't in there. They know now. You could do a literary tour of my constituency that would rival any others. Your starting point could be Mint Law to see the ancient Book of Deer. And the museum dedicated to it is a 10th century gospel, which survives as the earliest known Gaelic writing in Scotland. Then a 10-minute trip would take you to Strachan to find out more about the novelist Lorna Moon, who left the small town at the turn of the century and ended up being one of the top screenwriters in Hollywood in the 1920s. Her colourful life reads like a film script in itself. And then, another 10 minutes away, nip over to Fetter Angus and ask about Jean and Lucy Stewart, collectors and performers of the Northeast folk ballads from the travelling folk tradition, many influencing artists like Bob Dylan and inspiring the folk revival of the 1960s. Driving south towards Cruden Bay, as I've mentioned, you'd see the inspiration for Count Dracula's castle, Slane's Castle, on the edge of the magnificent cliffs of the Buchan Coast. That certainly fits the bill in terms of a dramatic setting for the home of one of literature's best-known characters. And Bram Stoker was a frequent summer guest, and he drew on its haunting qualities for his work. A top tip is to go at sunset, where the granite seems to glow red in the light. It's very spooky. Heading inland, you'll come across Gicht Castle. The spectacular, famously eerie castle, which is now a ruin, is perhaps most renowned for being the childhood home of George Gordon, which you'll all know better as the poet Lord Byron. Some of Scotland's best loved authors, one of Scotland's best loved authors, Lewis Grassic Gibbon, was born in Auchterless, just beside Turriff. So if, like me, if you're a fan of Sunset Song, before you head down to the Mearns, to where his works were set, you might want to see where he was born. But it's not just literary history that we have in abundance. Take those that have an interest in Robert the Bruce and the Wars of Scottish Independence. Once you've been to Bruce Crawford's constituency, you can come up to mine and see where Robert the Bruce and his brothers Edwards
following their footsteps as they drove out his enemy, the 3rd Earl of Buchan, and that was known as the Harrying of Buchan. And the battlefield in the Battle of Barra is currently under research to be inventoried and protected by Historic Scotland. And all this activity might explain why Aberdeenshire has more castles per acre than anyone else. A number of these castles are on the excellent National Trust for Scotland Castle Trail in Aberdeenshire, including Fyvie Castle. And of course, we've got the Bonnie Lassie of Fyvie. That song comes from that area too. And Haddo House in my constituency. And these castles are now part of the nation's fantastic cultural heritage. And I must also pay tribute to the fine work of the volunteer organisations such as the Tarvis, Turriff and Geary Heritage Centres in my constituency for keeping that history alive. Turning to archaeology, Aberdeenshire has a further unique attraction in our recumbent stone circles. These monuments are peculiar to the northeast. And there are a number of fine examples in my constituency, including Easter of Corthies near Inverurie, Lonehead of Davitt, and Achy Brae between Maud and New Deer. Now, an authority in these stones is the former rock star turned archaeology writer Julian Cope, who wrote The Modern Antiquarian, which is a directory of all the stone circles in the British Isles. And Julian has visited Aberdeenshire many times over the years to record the history and location of the many standing stones and circles. He's actually got a website as well if you ever want to find one near you. We have the highest concentration of standing stones anywhere in my constituency, or Aberdeen in general, Aberdeenshire in general. And my parents have a stone circle in their back field in Shieldon of Bertie near Lord Meldrum. And my mother was surprised to see Mr. Cope chapping on her door one afternoon, this long-haired bloke that she kind of recognised from Top of the Pops. And he was there to ask if he could have a look. And his visit's recorded in the book, although my mum's not mentioned. We also have the Pictish monument of the Bransbutt stone in Inverurie. Its carvings were dated to around AD 600. We've also got Roman remains from where the Picts drove them away from the camps. They didn't really sort of make much inroads into my area because we're hardy folk. So in this year of history, heritage and archaeology, we must encourage not only tourists, but those who live in Scotland to engage with our past. Not only because visiting our castles, heritage centres and attractions will help the economy, but because it will help us to better understand the present and pass on our culture and heritage to our kids. Kids love a ghost story. They also love a gory tale. So who needs Game of Thrones or Outlander when you've the real thing in your doorstep? We just need to bring it alive again by visiting these places and telling all the stories around them.
Maurice Corrie, to be followed by Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Gosh, what a wonderful walk through Scottish heritage you had this afternoon. It's absolutely brilliant. And I'd just like to say, commend Bruce Crawford for his excellent extolling of Stirling Castle, my regimental home. But what he failed to forget was the wonderful museum that's being developed there with a lot of government grant money, sorry, heritage lottery grant money, and it really is worthwhile going to see. So I do commend it too, although it's slightly out of my region, but it's in my regimental family, and I am passionately dear about that castle. As a Member of Parliament for West Scotland Region, I'm lucky enough to represent a part of Scotland which has many landmarks and historic sites which have both local and national significance. Where do I start? There are so many to count, and so I shall refer to some of the key ones in our area. We have Dumbarton Castle, another Argyll and Southern Highlander regimental area of the 9th Battalion, built atop the imposing volcanic plug, also known as Dumbarton Rock, with its spectacular views over the Clyde and Dumbarton for anyone who is willing to brave the 550 steps up to the top. There is also Kelben Castle near Fairlie in North Ayrshire, a 13th century castle which has been made, given a makeover in a very 21st century style by four Brazilian graffiti artists. Broderick Castle in the Isle of Arran, at the former seat of the Dukes of Hamilton, which is such an imposing and beautiful site that is on the back of the Royal Bank of Scotland £20 note. And in Helensburgh, my hometown, there is the Hill House, which was designed by the world... Yes, certainly.
Neil Finlay.
I think I picked him up right and said it was Brazilian graffiti artists, is that correct? Is there no graffiti artists in Dumbarton?
Maurice Corrie.
Mr Finlay, yeah, I'm sure there are. I knew of some of them for the 11 years that I served as company commander of the TA unit there, and I'm sure we certainly had a few in our unit anyway, but I'm more than happy to send them across there. Broderick Castle, in Helensburgh, there is the Hill House, which was designed by the world-renowned architects Charles and Margaret Rennie Mackintosh. In Old Kilpatrick, we have the west end of the Antonine Wall, and obviously the east end being at Falkirk, and that is well known in our area and well visited. We also have Paisley Abbey, which is recognised as the cradle of the Royal House of Stuart and is the burial place of all six of the High Stewards of Scotland. And being a Stuart myself, perhaps I should have declared an interest at that point. And there are just, and these are just to name a few of the sites in the west of Scotland that people from across the world flock to in their droves every year to see and marvel at. The benefits being social, cultural and economic, obviously, which these sites can bring to communities right across Scotland is something that all members of this Parliament, I'm sure, can agree on and welcome. According to the Historic Environment Scotland, who are one of the partner organisations helping to run Scotland's Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology, Scotland's History and Industry, which is supported by it, helps to secure more than 60,000 jobs and is worth over £2 billion a year to our economy. Not only are there economic benefits from our historic sites, which are of course welcome, but there's also the opportunity of Scots and visitors alike to learn and appreciate our shared history and heritage, which is untold benefit to our societies and communities across the country. So that's why all attempts to encourage people to visit Scotland, it's a historic site overall, and in particular to visit our many historic sites in the west of Scotland are very welcome. Theme years such as the Year of History, Heritage, Archaeology can play a big part in helping us to achieve that. And I'm glad to see that including this year's programme is Paisley's, and Mr. Adams will be delighted to hear that, International Festival of Weaving, which is running on the 1st and 2nd of July. I believe they will be holding some events in the Samarshot Cottage complex and also others across the town. The events cover 2 days, giving both locals and visitors alike the opportunity to connect with Paisley's proud history of weaving and textile manufacturing. And I think it's a great idea and I hope it goes well. And having myself started my business training and career in J.P. Coates, Anchor and Fergusley Mills in Paisley, I'm very pleased to see that this town's textile history and heritage is now being exposed and indeed promoted to the world at large. I'm glad that my colleague Alexander Stewart, in his amendment, is highlighting the vital role which Visit Scotland and the partner organisations are playing. And these are Creative Scotland, Historic Environment Scotland, Heritage Lottery Fund, National Trust of Scotland, Scottish Enterprise, Built Environment Forum Scotland, Heritage Tourism Group, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, Scottish Tourism Alliance, Traditional Arts and Culture Scotland, or known as TRACS, and Museum Gallery Scotland. All these organisations are helping to promote the Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology in Scotland and around the world. Without organisations like these doing the hard work in helping our tourism industry, I am actually sure that it will be a lot smaller and not contributing to the economy and society in general as much as it currently is. I mentioned Museum Gallery Scotland, and I wanted to take the opportunity to note their work. And in particular, I was lucky enough to visit the Clydebank Museum with them late last year. The museum holds a number of superb exhibitions on shipbuilding on the Clyde, including one that is the name of every single ship that was ever built on the Clyde. What a great heritage for Scotland. Another great museum which will be opening in my hometown of Helensburgh this year is the Scottish Submarine Centre, which will exhibit and commemorate the Royal Navy's submarine service. And I know that the Cabinet Secretary is aware of that, and indeed her visit to the Big Brother, the Tower Centre, some year ago or so. The museum itself is going to be exhibiting a real midget submarine, HMS Stickleback, on display alongside a digital exhibition, giving visitors, including those with family members in the submarine service, the opportunity to see what the day-to-day life of submariners is really like. As Alexander Stewart points out correctly, it is vitally important that our tourism and development agencies are adequately funded and resourced to help this incredibly important sector to thrive and therefore ensure that Scotland remains a world-class tourism destination. I shall be supporting Alexander Stewart's amendment. Thank you.
The last of the open speakers is Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I also warmly welcome 2017 as the Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology and the opportunities that it will provide to celebrate Edinburgh, Northern and Leith's vibrant history and heritage and to raise the profile of the area I represent and of Scotland as a whole. Presiding Officer, Edinburgh, Northern and Leith makes a significant contribution to Scotland's profile and its strong reputation as a world-class tourism destination. whether arriving in Leith on a cruise ship at the waterfront, which is a growing trend amongst visitors, or travelling from the town centre of Edinburgh down into the area, Edinburgh Northern and Leith is replete with superb attractions for visitors all around the world. Attractions of real historical significance that are a key part of our shared national heritage. From the fishing communities of New Haven to the industry of Granton, from the internationalism of the old port of Leith to the influence of imperial commerce and the slave trade in the residential development of Inverleith and Trinity, the history and heritage of the constituency I have the privilege to represent is varied and complex and bound into our wider stories and the achievements and the mistakes of generations past. The most famous of the attractions in my area are, of course, the Royal Yacht Britannia, which has been settled in Leith Docks for several years now, and the Royal Britannic Gardens, which was established in 1670 as Scotland's premier civic garden and is the second most important botanic garden in the UK. It moved into Leith in 1793 and then in 1820 was relocated in Inverleith where it is now. And I pay tribute to all the efforts of the Royal Botanic Garden in terms of conserving Scotland's biodiversity and its efforts in trying to reduce climate change. However, as well as these famous examples, there are also many other less well-known attractions and sites of historical significance in Edinburgh, Northern and Leith. Granton Harbour was where Queen Victoria landed in Scotland in September 1842. And today, Granton Harbour is in a process of being rejuvenated as a waterfront attraction for our country. The National Museum of Scotland and National Galleries of Scotland have collection centres in the north of the city. And consideration is underway to make these facilities, these fantastic facilities, more accessible in order to display more of our heritage to the public. In Leith, there is, of course, rich heritage from the old docks to the civic journey of Leith itself, from the legacy of that process and Leith's democratic journey to products that we that are associated with our everyday life that were invented in Leith, from Rosie's Lime Cordial to Gleva, from the grain spirit that was key to the development of London Dry Gin to modern cultural phenomena like train spotting, and of course, we're all excited to see train spotting too if we haven't seen it already. Indeed.
Neil Finlay.
I think I'm glad he came to that because one of the serious points in this, and when I've spoken to people in those communities during the festival, is that they feel completely and utterly detached from much of the stuff that goes on in Edinburgh around all of these cultural events. So how are we getting out to communities in Granton and Wester Hales and Nidre and the rest of it?
Ben McPherson.
Very good point, Neil Fillion. I was first of all going to say that I think train spotting as a phenomenon tells us all about not just the character of Leith, but about the social economic challenges that we all face in trying to help communities like Leith. But also, for example, there were moves to try and get the Premier to be in Leith, and I was in correspondence on that behind the scene in terms of train spotting too. But I'm just going to move to some other aspects of tourism in Leith that may create opportunities like that. For example, there are the Leith Theatre, which I know that the Cabinet Secretary has been engaged in, which was unfortunately closed in 1988. There are moves now to re-establish that and use that as a cultural hub in order to spread the benefits of our festivals into other parts of the city. The Leith Rules Golf Society, who are working hard to establish an attraction on Leith Links where the first rules of golf were created in 1744. That can bring benefits to Leith. And also, there are a great group of volunteers involved in Leith Dock in trying to rejuvenate the SS Explorer, which was one of Scotland's first purpose-built ocean-going fisheries research vessels, one of the lead research facilities for Scotland for 28 years. And also, I'm delighted to say that the Fire Museum will also be coming to Leith soon. And Leith is also home to Scotland's first virtual reality centre and the possibilities that can bring. The heritage of Hibernian Football Club is also, of course, a big part of Leith's history, and the historic cup win meant a huge amount to the community and will be remembered fondly for a long time. By many. Presiding Officer, lastly, I'd like to finish on the history of Leith as a vibrant hub for Scotland's multicultural journey and burgeoning diversity. As a seaport and as a community, as more and more families have made the area their home, Leith has developed over the decades into a positive and inspiring tapestry of ethnicities and faiths, many threads and stories woven into the united colours of a shared and modern one international Scotland. From the Gurdwara at the shore to South Leith Parish Church, from the Annandale Street Mosque to St Mary's Star of the Sea, Leith today represents the best of Scotland's diverse religious heritage. From Polish cafes like Yellow Bench to established Italian restaurants like Vittoria, from social enterprises like Punjabi Junction to Portuguese coffee shops like Casa Amiga, Leith today embodies the richness and strength of Scotland's multicultural history. So, Presiding Officer, in closing, with all that is going on this island and around the world at the moment, as we celebrate and recognise 2017 as the Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology, let us remember that the most important history and heritage we share, and the one that we must always celebrate, recognise and promote, is our internationalist shared history and heritage, our shared common humanity.
We move to the closing speeches, and I call on Neil Findlay. No more than 6 minutes, please, Mr. Findlay.
Thanks very much. I'm very happy to support initiatives that bring people to visit our great country and all that it offers, and that creates and sustains employment and stimulates interest in our people and its history. We have been certainly around the country this afternoon, from Brazilian graffiti artists in Dumbarton, Stirling Castle, Falkirk Wheel, Summerlee Heritage Museum, Netherton. We've been to Neolithic Orkney, and we've even had a mention of the ex-lead singer of the Teardrop Explodes. I understand Mr. McArthur mentioned Orkney, and I understand his partner in crime, Mr. Scott, is not here today. I think he may be engaged in some culture at Up Helly Ah. He's probably in the pub, I would imagine. But this debate got me thinking about past and present issues that dominate our historical narrative. It also got me wondering about whether, against the backdrop of savage cuts to local government and other public services, this initiative and others like it can be implemented effectively, reaching out not just to the usual people, but to everyone, or whether, like much of what the government does, it appears to be a good initiative, but maybe is less so when you scratch the surface. I could have probably recited Stuart Stevenson's family history, as I've heard it so often in this chamber. Could I say at least he spared the chamber his story of his career inventing the internet, being a pilot, a water bailiff, and the numerous other absolutely fascinating events in Mr. Stevenson's life. He also spared you the story of, I think it's Mary Queen of Scots and her trunk of treasure, where keys go all over the place. Don't worry, he will bring it back to the chamber several times before you leave this place. I think, just a moment, I think Jackson Carlow and I are probably on our sixth version of it. Mr. Crawford.
Bruce Crawford.
A member might like to know that during the debate, Stuart Stevenson passed me a note about Robert Bontine Cunningham Graham, where he said he is the great uncle of the spouse of a great nephew of a spouse and the second cousin once removed. Beat that one.
Neil Findlay.
You started that off by saying you may be interested to know. You're incorrect on that point. Could I say, I have to ask if the government is asking communities, councils and local groups to put on events and promote the Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology without actually putting money behind it. Because this year, councils, we know, are threatened with a further £327 million worth of cuts on top of all the rest of the cuts that they have had to put up with over 10 years of government. You don't need to be Professor Tom Devine, who was one of my ex-university lecturers, to work out that the ability of local authorities to maintain and invest in culture and heritage is fatally undermined by such an approach. Across the board, we see grants to local history groups and cultural organisations cut. We see museums and galleries and libraries threatened and staff losing their jobs. It's hardly surprising when choices have to be made between social care and museums and nursery education and galleries that cultural funding is often seen as an easy target. And in such circumstances, we are all the losers
before it, but some councils haven't sat back and complained. They've offered solutions. Authorities in Aberdeen and Edinburgh have called for the power to implement a tourist levy so they can invest in those things that bring, attract tourists here in the first place. Yet I understand the Scottish Government has so far failed to support. Maybe the Minister would like to take the opportunity now to advise us whether she supports that initiative or not. Apparently not. It also got me thinking about the history that's promoted in our schools and communities and which reaches into the national and local psyche, because I think local history is the history that resonates most with people, not the histories of kings and queens and battles of centuries ago, but their local identity, the identity associated with development of their village or town, a particular industry or sector. Their class and cultural identity is central to how that community sees itself and its history. The history of steel and textiles and oil and fishing is what people identify with. The history of a West Lothian or Mid Lothian mining community is much more in common with a South Wales mining community than the history of a Highland country estate. Their history, those people's history, is not dominated by Wallace and Bruce or Mary Queen of Scots. It's dominated by hard graft and struggle for better conditions, wages, improved housing, education for their children, and development of their community built on common aims and bonds of solidarity. I see I've only got a minute left, Presiding Officer. I think that that kind of history is the history that people want to learn about and celebrate. But I wonder how many of the projects the Cabinet Secretary promotes and how much of the money spent will go to communities and projects that hit right at the grassroots. How much of that money, and the point I was making to Ben McPherson, will go to places like Nidre and Broomhouse and Castlemilk and Milton and Whitfield, or areas that are in real need of investment, areas that very often, all too often, miss out on investment in this type of investment. And we need to critically analyse our history also and learn from it. And I think we need to learn about things like Scotland's role in empire building, in the slave trade. We need to hear about huge political figures like Hardy and Maxton, Jimmy Reid and others. Events like the UCS and Timex and Piper Alpha, about Scotland's...
must come to a close, Mr. Finlay.
Glasgow's role in fighting apartheid. All of these things are what we should learn about. It's not just about targeting new initiatives towards the usual people. It's about encouraging everyone.
I call on Jamie Green. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr. Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's been an interesting and fascinating debate. We've had everything from fornication to eloping, battles of old over land and battles new over funding. Admittedly, history was never my strong point at school, but I did spend a fair amount of time with a metal detector in the fields near my house searching for old coins, and I recall the excitement of finding a penny that was 100 years old. As an adult, that excitement is best expressed by sitting on my sofa watching catch-up television. And programmes like last night's fascinating insight into King George III, the genius of a mad king, whose entire archive of letters is now available online to browse. So you or I control the hundreds and thousands of pages of manuscripts and interpret for ourselves the world that he lived in, especially his relationship with politicians, perhaps. But we are all now historians ourselves. So the way that we access the past has changed, but the excitement of discovery still remains. Colleagues from across the chamber have talked about the importance of Scottish heritage for tourism, culture, and education. We've discussed the need to foster the skills and craftsmanship that maintaining our historic buildings requires. Turning to some of the contributions, Maurice Corey spoke of our shared region, in Arran and Barton and across the Clyde region, but he also suggested these sites do not offer just cultural importance to us, but they help directly to the economy. In fact, in page 3 of today's Scotsman, I read about the new Jacobite Trail, which is being launched, so which covers a huge part of my region also. Oliver Mundell spoke about Robert Burns, no longer confined to suppers and speeches. You can also walk the hills that he walked and get foo in the pubs that he frequented. Alison Harris spoke about the great role that Falkirk has played in the history of Scotland. Alexander Stewart spoke of the importance of bringing together creative industries, museums, trusts, and our agencies, but he also came with a warning that we cannot be complacent, that the world we're in today, tourism is fiercely competitive. Getting on a plane is just as easy as getting on a bus. The Cabinet Secretary talked about ancestry and clans as main reasons why people come to Scotland. I also think that golf and whiskey are two others, and in that respect, I recommend a visit to the Isle of Arran. Stuart Stevenson spoke at great length of the importance of genealogy and his family's criminality. Claire Adamson of Motherwell, Liam MacArthur eloquently of Orkney, Bruce Crawford of Stirling, and Ben McPherson of Leith and the Royal Yacht Britannia, which I visited a few weeks ago, and thoroughly recommend that. But in addition to some of those contributions, let me add some thoughts of my own. The promotion of heritage tourism is not just a matter of visitor numbers. There are a host of benefits. Jobs, indirect and direct, using local suppliers and artisans to restore and maintain buildings, supporting the development of craft skills, some of which are at danger of disappearing in Scotland, but also working with academia and education to bring to life classroom theory with field studies and practical work, such as the excellent work that Digit is doing. Lewis MacDonald importantly spoke of the direct relationship between Scotland's councils and supporting culture. And on these benches, we hope that culture is not first on the list when councils are proposing and voting on cuts. And for that reason, we will be supporting his amendment. But when planning for future construction and development, we should always be mindful of preservation. And looking to the future need not be a contradiction when preserving the past. What is clear to me from my own portfolio's point of view is that we should use technology to promote Scotland. In the garden lobby a few weeks ago, I tried out the new virtual reality app on offer, Scotland VR, and it's a good start. I commend it. But we should know that over a million people a month use Samsung's VR product. Tens of millions of people are using the PlayStation VR product. There are bigger opportunities that allow people to put on a headset and transport themselves from their home overseas into Edinburgh Castle or Burns House or even the inside of this chamber. Technology is also able to ensure that our national landmarks are preserved in a very sustainable way. And a good example of that is the, excuse my pronunciation, the Plas Newydd Mansion in Wales, which is powered by sea energy from the Menai Strait. Now, this is home to the biggest marine source heat pump in the UK. It swaps oil fuel for sea energy, and that marine source heat provides 100% of the heating that the house needs to keep warm, saving around £40,000 a year in operating costs. And that's money that can be reinvested back into the conservation of the house and its art collections. It's just a fine example of what can be achieved if we take a cross-sector approach to conservation. In conclusion today, our amendment simply asks that the government keeps a mindful eye on the resources and funding required to maintain the high standards of tourism and history and heritage that we have become accustomed to in Scotland. And for that reason, we would ask the Chamber to support our amendment, and equally we will be supporting Labour's. Thank you.
I call on Fiona Hislop to wind up in this debate. 8 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, what a fascinating, informative and indeed impassioned debate. I think the only sourness, unsurprisingly, was Neil Findlay with sweeping generalisation and unresearched assertions. And I would compare that actually with what we've just heard from Jamie Green, which I think was a speech that had knowledge. He spoke about the skills, the jobs and the impact and also the use of technology. And I think that's what's been very important in this debate, is the knowledge, the impassion, but also the challenge about what we can and should be doing. I might want to point out to Jamie Green that I've been supporting research into a heat pump for Linlithgow Loft, precisely in a similar vein as to what can be done within that area and obviously with Linlithgow Palace. In terms of the historic environment and in terms of the themed years, they are essentially a tourism opportunity to bring together, I think as Alexander Stewart said, different agencies, and we're seeing the benefits of that agency working. It's creating a sense of place, we know, for our villages, our towns and cities. It generates employment and training, and also that inspiration for learning and education itself. But it does need careful stewardship. And I do agree that we should always seek to provide sufficient resources for culture and heritage, or in the terms of the amendments, adequate resources to do so. And that has been a priority for me within the culture portfolio for some time. I pointed out earlier that Visit Scotland's budget for the next financial year will be maintained if the budget is approved at £43.9 million. Although there are still challenges within that, that has been well received from the tourism sector. And to Lewis MacDonald, I would also remind him of the increase in Historic Environment Scotland's capital budget, precisely to address the conservation works identified in the condition survey I instructed. So that additional £6.6 million, only goes some way and is a start in terms of what we have to do. But again, it's a commitment, as is that overall increase should the budget be approved for Historic Environment Scotland. But yes, indeed.
Lewis MacDonald.
I'm very grateful and I acknowledge the point about the £6.6 million. Will she likewise acknowledge that while visitor attractions like Edinburgh Castle and Stirling Castle will repay that investment relatively quickly, some of the issues around the estate are actually for less well-known, less well-visited places which actually require just a significant investment over
Fiona
time.
Fiona Hislop.
And I think that's the challenge, is how do we make sure that the visitors that come to Edinburgh in particular actually enjoy all the stories and all the places that we've heard out throughout this year, because spreading the experience and spreading the income is really, really important. I mean, we do have to recognise the very specific challenges. And I think what's been great about this debate is not only have we had the impassioned enthusiasm for different constituencies and what they have to offer, but genuine issues that have to be raised. And I will say to Liam MacArthur and the points that he raised, particularly around Maze Howe, I take a keen interest in that and in the attraction and the visitor centre there, but also on archaeology. I think that was a point raised by a number of people, Lewis MacDonald, but also from Claire Adamson in the context of the M74 and what that has revealed in terms of the archaeology work there. So in terms of the debate, I thought Colin Beattie gave a very thoughtful contribution. I thought his quote of history isn't something that's ever over is very apt, but he also reminded us as the context of that, and he started, I think, what was a theme throughout the debate about the importance of intangible heritage and the story of people. He talked about the Musselmore Ridings and the Dalkeith Country Park. I thought Alison Harris made an excellent contribution when she talked about Falkirk. And I think we know so much, perhaps, about Glasgow and the shipbuilding and industrialisation of our country, but the story of Central Belt Scotland and the contribution to the industrialisation and the stories of individual has to be told. I might point out that, of course, although Blackness Castle is in Falkirk District, it was always the port for Linlithgow, which is in my constituency. But I think that's really important. That comes back to the point raised by a number of people, that this is not just about visitor attraction, it's also about how we can help communities find out more about their own area, and I think in particular around schools and the importance of that. Jamie? Yep.
Jamie Green.
Cabinet Secretary for taking my intervention, but does she appreciate the genuine concern that we have on both sides of the chamber that the potential of cuts to local government may have a knock-on effect on culture, which maybe is not as high up as, on the list as other public services, and that's a genuine concern in this chamber?
Fiona Hislop.
We'll leave the budget debate for another day, but you can't square calling for more money without saying where that money will come from. But I would say in relation to this debate and in relation to the signature event money, that's precisely to help local communities to run events. All these events, by and large, are run with local councils. And it's one of the reasons I've brought together culture conveners from across local authorities to identify where they can share best practice. But also, I think there's a real merit in trying to help share the experience of events within local authorities. Some are better than others. No, I think we've heard enough from Mr. Finlay in this debate. Yeah, no, I'm sorry, Mr. Finlay. I'm sorry, Mr. Finlay. I want to address other people who made more constructive contributions to this debate, including his colleague Elaine Smith, who talked about Coster Cote Bridge, yes, but also the importance of the telling the stories of women and Janet Hamilton and the poems and ballads that she wrote. I thought Claire Adamson was correct to name-check Professor Tom Devine, who was a lecturer who taught me about economic history. And I think that story about people and place is the strongest. And not everything is done by by national organisations or national public bodies. Indeed, I think the tribute played by Liam MacArthur to Sandy Heritage Trust, I think also from Oliver Mundell in relation to some of the local activity around the Devil's Porridge Museum. Again, a story about women and women's contribution to Scotland's history in terms of munitions and the factories there. I didn't know there was a tsunami in Stirling that brought whalebones up to the cars, but I do now. But Bruce Crawford also made the economic point that the result of our themed years means that we can get economic benefit, and the contribution, for example, of the Year of Food and Drink, to have £1 billion spent by tourism on food and drink, shows the economic benefit of promoting those areas. Now, virtual reality was mentioned by a number of contributors, and again, it's how do we take that fantastic heritage and make sure it's broadcast to encourage people to take part in a modern way. I was a bit worried that we'd forgotten about the pics until Gillian Martin made her contribution, but again, she reiterated, this is about stories. And I think we need to tell the stories in all their different iterations. And I think the industrial stories, particularly Maurice Corrie mentioned Paisley and the textile industry, these are all things that I think are part of the fabric of Scotland, and I think we're the better for it. So whether it's the National Trust for Scotland, whether it's local community development trusts, whether it's local family history, as we heard from Stuart Stevenson, they all have a part to play in that story of Scotland. But there are 200,000 people employed by tourism, and our history, heritage and archaeology underpins all of that. We have to develop the skills that is needed to ensure we can exploit that. We have to make sure we have the promotion. But every single person in this chamber tonight has talked about Scotland spirit. And the Scots Spirit campaign that Visit Scotland is carrying out will want to capture everybody's authentic experience of their local place. And I would encourage every member that has contributed today to make sure they record their message about their constituency and help that authentic promotion of Scotland.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes our debate on celebrating our past. The next item of business is consideration of motion 3514 in the name of Claire Adamson on gender balance on the Parliamentary Bureau and SPCB. And I call on Claire Adamson to move the motion on behalf of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Following the Scottish Parliament elections, an all-male parliamentary bureau was appointed and an all-male Scottish parliamentary corporate body was elected. The Presiding Officer subsequently wrote to the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee, inviting us to consider this lack of gender balance and whether any new rules were required. He commented that it reflected poorly on the Parliament, given its strong commitment to equal opportunities. We share the Presiding Officer's concerns, and we therefore are proposing some new rules about gender balance on the Bureau and the Scottish Parliament corporate body. First, there would be a new requirement on party leaders to consult each other and have regard to gender balance before nominating members of the Bureau. And second, members intending to nominate someone to the corporate body would need to have regard to gender balance before making such a nomination. We believe these proposed rules will help promote gender balance on these two bodies. However, they are not prescriptive in nature and would not, for example, require there to be gender balance. We do not wish to restrict the rights of members to decide who best to represent them. We have consulted with both the Scottish Parliament corporate body and the Bureau, and both are content with this proposal. Approach. I'm pleased to move motion S5M03514 in my name.
Thank you very much. And the question on this motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 3777 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a revised business programme. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press their request to speak button now, and I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 3777. No member has asked to speak against the motion. I'll therefore put the question to the chamber. The question is that motion 3777 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. There are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that Amendment 3748.2 in the name of Alexander Stewart, which seeks to amend Motion 3748 in the name of Fiona Hislop on celebrating our past, Scotland's Year of History, Heritage and Archaeology, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The next question is that Amendment 3748.1 in the name of Lewis MacDonald, which seeks to amend the motion in the name of Fiona Hislop, be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The next question is that Motion 3748 in the name of Fiona Hislop, as amended, on celebrating our past, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. And the final question is that Motion 3514 in the name of Claire Adamson, on behalf of the Standards Committee, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. That concludes decision time. And we'll now move to members' business in the name of Graham Day. We'll just take a few moments to change seats.